Thank you. the cross. It was meant to horrify the world. It was meant for humiliation. It was meant to last for days. It was meant for slow asphyxiation. It was meant to prolong torture. It was the Roman soldier's job. It was meant to be used by Caesar, but instead, it was used by God. It was meant to stop a movement, but instead, it became the way. It was meant to act on fear, but instead, it awakened faith. It was meant to be vicious and violent, but instead, it became our peace. It was meant to uproot hope, but instead, it became the seed. It was meant to punish captives, but instead, it unleashed freedom. It was meant to build up Rome, but instead, it built God's kingdom. It was meant to discourage rebels. It was meant to stop insurrection. It was meant to put down Jesus, but instead, it set up his resurrection. It was meant to jeer and mock him, but instead, it was his glory. It was meant to erase a chapter, but instead, it became the story. It was meant to hold up convicts, but instead, it raised up a king. It was meant to shut our mouth, but instead, it's why we sing. It was meant to be a judgment, but instead, it became our mercy. It's why the song of heaven is the Lamb. The Lamb is worthy. It was meant to kill an enemy, crush dissenters and diversion, but instead it became the banner of God's love for every person. It was meant to be appalling, nailing hands and feet to wood. It was meant to be used for evil, but instead it was used for good. It was meant to be a symbol of God's assassination. But instead, it became the symbol of Jesus' invitation. Come to the cross. Instead of sin and stain, you are meant to be made clean. Instead of being forgotten, you are meant to know your sin. Instead of being ashamed, you can leave behind your guilt. Instead of feeling empty, you were meant to be fulfilled. Instead of being broken, you are meant to be made whole. Here, Calvary is calling. It beckons you. Behold, come to the cross. Instead of being an accident, you have a purpose and a plan. Instead of being abandoned, you were chosen by his hand. For all who've said I can't, God has said I can. No matter what you've done, the invitation stands. Come to the cross. Instead of being doubtful, you are meant to know your Father. You are meant to be his son, and you are meant to be his daughter. You were cherished from the start. You were always in the picture. Instead of being a victim, you were meant to be a victor. The result of Jesus' blood, salvation has arrived. Instead of being dead, you are meant to be alive. The cross. It was meant to signal death, but instead, it's a sign of living. It was meant to be the end, but instead, it's our beginning.
Thank you. Well, good morning, Beacon Life family. I want you to clap your hands all over the building. I want to welcome you to our 10 a.m. Resurrection Sunday service. I want you to get excited because we are here to celebrate that one name on this morning. And what is that one name? It is the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus right now. So I want you to stand all over the building. Go ahead and greet your neighbor. Tell him you're glad to be in the house with him on this morning. That's right, greet your neighbor with a smile on this morning. Hallelujah. That's right. Your prayer posture, whatever that may be, and I invite you to join me right here at the altar where we can cast our cares and lay them at the feet of our Father. Also, our prayer wall is still available out in the foyer for you to cast your cares there as well. So our scripture on this morning comes from 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 and 4, and this is from the Good News Translation, and it says, "Let us give thanks to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ because of his great mercy." His mercy is so great, y'all. He gives us new life by raising Jesus Christ from death. This fills us with a living hope, living hope. It fills us with a living hope. And so we look forward. We look forward to possessing the rich blessings that God keeps for us in heaven. He keeps for you in heaven where they cannot spoil or decay or fade away. So let us pray on this morning. Lift your hands all over the building. Father God, we love you. We honor you. We lift your name high, oh God. There is no other name like yours in this earth, oh God. So we come this morning to give you all the glory, all the praise, all the honor, oh God, because you're so worthy. We thank you for bringing us here this morning to give us another opportunity to lift your name high. We say hallelujah this morning, oh God, because Jesus is risen. We can rejoice because he came to save us, and we give your name glory, oh God. So right now, Father God, we want to say thank you. We thank you for the blood of Jesus. We thank you that the blood still has power, and that the blood still works, and that the blood is stronger than anything that we can face in this life. So we say hallelujah, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, God. And Father God, we open our hearts to you on this morning. We want to receive from you on this morning. We want to hear what you're saying to us on this morning. Speak to our hearts, oh God. We want to feel your presence on this morning, oh God. Have your way in this place, oh God. Move by your spirit in this place, oh God. We want to feel your presence, Father God. We want to feel your presence in this place. So we say glory to your name, oh God. And we thank you once again, Father God. Thank you for Jesus. Let's say thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, right now. And Lord, as we seal this prayer, we say hallelujah again.
salvation, the Bible says rejoice, and again I say rejoice. It can be a lifted hand, it can be hands that are clapping, it can be mouths that are moving, but can we enter this gate with thanksgiving? Can we enter this court, even the virtual court, with praise? For Father, you didn't just stay there, but you resurrected your Son, that we could have life and have life more abundantly. So we came in with the praise. We came in with gratitude. We came in with a hallelujah, because that one hallelujah has birthed so many testimonies day after day and year after year. And Father, if you don't hear a song, you'll hear our praise, because you sent your Son to die. He was filled with blood. His veins were ripped and torn. And because the cat of nine tails ripped off his flesh, we can walk into the doctor's office and believe the report of the Lord. We can speak over our lives and declare that all is well. So no matter what we came in here with, we cast our cares and we rejoice. We forget about ourselves and we concentrate on Him, and we rejoice knowing that what you promised, you're gonna do. So while you do what you do, we're gonna do what we came in here to do. We'll lift our hands and rejoice. We're gonna enter this gate with thanksgiving, because you've been so good. You're worth this praise. You're worth this hallelujah. And we will rejoice. Say, we will rejoice. Last time, we will rejoice. Now, I just need you to praise the King of Kings right now. I'm not trying to pump you. I'm not trying to prime you.
Hallelujah.
And if that's your best, I'll leave you alone. But my uncle used to say, when I think of the goodness of Jesus,
hallelujah,
woo, and all that He's done for me, my soul says hallelujah. Because when I was sick, He resurrected healing.
Hallelujah.
When I was in the midst of grief, He resurrected His peace. When I was in the midst of confusion, He resurrected His wonderful counselor to meet my needs. And if He doesn't do another thing else, I'll still bless Him for all that He has
hallelujah
done. For this is the day that the Lord has made.
Yes.
You let us see this day. You let us see this Sunday, and we come in here with a resurrected praise. We come in here with a fresh hallelujah, knowing that you're able, knowing that you're mighty. Worthy you were back then, worthy you are right now, and worthy you'll always be. For the Lord is good, and His mercy endureth forever. Somebody praise the good God.
Hallelujah.
You ready to praise Him? You ready to praise Him? Hallelujah. Come on, let's exalt His name together. Put your hands on it like this. Come on, Trey.
Hey.
Hey. Hey. Hey. Hey.
Come to bless our good God. Anybody believe we serve a good God? Somebody say, Lord, you are good.
You are good,
come on,
enduring forever.
Lift it up in the room.
provided. You're such a good God. You're such a good God. We thank you, Jesus. Worthy of our praises.
John wrote in Revelation, he said that he saw angels at the throne saying, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain." Worth means weight. Its root word means that. So something that's so great deserves the weight of our worship, the weight of our praise. And Father, we thank you for being a God who's worth our worship, who's worth our praise. So even now, can you just give him what he's due? I know it might be new for some of us, but on this resurrection day, Father, we thank you, Lord God, for giving us the freedom to bless you. When we needed provision, you were Jireh. When we needed peace, you were Shalom. You kept us day after day and week after week. Certain things we never thought we could bear, but you gave us the strength to carry. So we worship the one name. Oh, we bless you, we bless you, we bless you. You're worthy of our worship, God. Shiva. wonderful name, and it's great to be praised. One more time, tell them, say, glory. Worthy you. Worthy you. Worthy you will be.
Worthy you will be.
Worthy. You've done miracles, signs and wonders. Forever you will be. Back then you were worthy. Right now you are worthy. Forever you.
He's worthy to be praised this morning. I'm sorry, I said he's worthy to be praised. Oh, he's worthy not to be applauded, to be praised is our God. Come on, say that forever, forever. Come on, let God hear your mouth this morning. God, I didn't just show up, but I wanted to let you hear my worship this morning. Come on, lift it up all over the house of the Lord. Forever, Yahweh. Lord, we want to let you know from everlasting to everlasting, your name is worthy to be praised. Hallelujah. Yes. Oh, forever. Yes. Yes, forever. Come on, can you lift your hand? Can you lift your hand today? Come on, lift them high as you believe God has taken your life. Amen. Yes. Come on, don't hold anything back, Father. We lift them. We lift our hands today. We've gathered today not just for celebration and reflection. We gather this morning to worship our risen Savior and our life-changing King, Lord God. So today, Lord, in the midst of all of these people here today, we sing before you as an audience of one, Lord God. It's not about my neighbor's voice or the person in front of me's voice, Lord. It's my voice that I'm giving to you this morning. I want you to know that you are worthy forever of all of my praise and honor and glory, Lord God. We thank you that creation gives you glory. We thank you right now that you have the ability to let rocks cry out for you. Oh, but this morning on this Resurrection Sunday, I don't need a rock to cry out for me. I don't need creation only to give you glory. I open up my mouth and I give you praise all over the house of the Lord. Come on, somebody, while your hands are lifted, I give you worship, God. I give you what I can't give my spouse, what I can't give my children. Worthy you are. Worthy you are. Hallelujah. Forever, Yahweh. Worthy you are, God. Hallelujah. Forever. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. How many of y'all know God is worthy to be praised today? Amen. Come on, this is the week that changed the whole world. I believe your response should be a little bit more intensified than that. Hallelujah. Come on, let's thank God today, because there's an empty grave to prove that my Savior yet lives. Hallelujah. I don't know about y'all, but I ain't turning back. I'm standing on the word of God. He is the resurrection, the truth and the light. Hallelujah. Can you reach over and make contact with your neighbor before we take our seats today? Tell them, I'm so glad you're in worship this morning. Come on, tell that other neighbor before they get jealous. Say, I'm so glad you're here this morning. Hallelujah. Come on, can we pray together? Can we do that together since we're gathered in worship? Father, we thank you for this time of unity prayer. We believe, Lord God, that as we come together in worship, we could have stayed at home. We could have did this on our couch, Lord. But we gathered together because something happens when we gather live, Lord God. I thank you and I bless you now for the hands that we're holding this morning, Lord God. I thank you that we can touch and agree with what's going to take place in this room, Lord God. We thank you right now that it's not just taking place for us, but it's taking place for everybody that's connected to us, Lord God. So we bind up a spirit of selfishness this morning, Lord God. So my praise is not just for me. My praise is for my neighbor's deliverance. My praise is for my person in front of me's breakthrough, Lord God. My praise, Lord God, and if you don't do nothing for me, would you do it for them? Would they leave here today with a testimony of your goodness, your grace, and your mercy? Lord God, hallelujah. We give you glory and we give you honor and we give you praise today, Lord God. Lord, may our heart and our attention be focused on Jesus this morning. I thank you for the crowd. I thank you for the overflow. But Lord, I thank you right now, Lord, that today our gaze is upon that empty tomb, Lord God. That is a testimony, Lord God, that if he got up, we can get up from anything that we are facing in here today. So we thank you for the spirit of encouragement this morning. We thank you for a new resolution and a new resolve that we're going to have, a fresh determination when we leave this place today, Lord God. May the spirit of resurrection now be upon every single one of us. We love you today, God. We give you praise, we give you honor, and we give you glory in Jesus' name. Amen, amen, amen. Come on, clap those hands all over the house of the Lord this morning. Listen, I know it's a little tight, and whether you're in the sanctuary or you're in overflow, before you take your seats, I want to give you a temporary minister's license. I got to get him back in about 60 seconds. A temporary minister's license. I want you to hug somebody and tell them you still have the victory. Amen. Come on, tell him, I don't care what's been going on in your life. I don't care what you brought in here this morning. But resurrection teaches us that we still, come on, we still have the victory. We still have the victory. We still have the victory. And you're worthy. And you're worthy. Come on, anybody that's radical here today, say, God, you're worthy. Worthy, God. Forever. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, let's praise our God. Come on, if you believe he's worthy to be praised forever, he's worthy to be praised forever. Come on, he's worthy to be praised forever and ever and ever and ever ever. Hallelujah. He's worthy to be praised. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Amen. 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 We greet all of you in divine love. Go ahead and have your seats in the house of the Lord. Say something back to me when I say God is good. Amen. All the time and all the time, God is good. Well, we are gathered here on this very special Sunday. Amen. Well, we come to celebrate our life-changing King. Amen. Come on, if he's your Savior, you got to say something. Amen. You got to open up your mouth. Amen. I know many of you hold special titles and positions, and many of you have platforms and all of those type of things. Amen. But when we come into worship, amen, there's a certain uniform that all of us put on. Amen. That we take our titles off at the door. We take our status off. We take our platforms off. And we come to say, God, we are worshipers in the house of the Lord today. And your name is the only name that's worthy to be praised. Come on, everybody here today that know that Jesus is, amen, your risen King. I want you to clap your hands. Don't look at your neighbor. Don't act like what they're doing. Come on, God, I bless you for what you did for me. Hallelujah. Amen. And we greet you in divine love. Whether you walked in this morning or logged in, we thank God for all of you. Can you clap your hands for our virtual church this morning? Those of you that's watching us on YouTube, on Facebook, amen, on Instagram, we thank and bless God for you sharing with us on today as well. I also want to just pause and thank God for my lovely wife who ministers right by our side. Can you help me appreciate her on this morning? God bless you, our First Lady. And I love my mother-in-law. She decided to come and worship with us for Easter, for resurrection today. Would you stand, mother-in-law? Won't y'all thank God? I got a beautiful mother-in-law. Amen. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. We appreciate you. She's staying at the house, I hope, for a few days. Amen. Praise God. I love it. I know I heard some stories about mother-in-laws. Amen. That's not my testimony. Amen. I got a good mother-in-law. Amen. I thank God for her. Amen. For almost 30 years now. Amen. Never had an argument with her in 30 years. Amen. She minds her business. Amen. She don't start trying to get into our house. Amen. And she love on me. Amen. I thank God for her. Amen. Then my oldest is home from college. I know y'all ain't seen him in a while. Clap your hands for D3, who's here today. Come on, clap your hands. He's been away in college. I don't know if he's still saved or not. Amen. But he's finishing up his second semester, amen, of college. Amen. And I just, how many of y'all got college students, teenagers? Amen. You just got to release them to the Lord. Amen. I'm just glad he's here this morning. Amen. I didn't know if he was going to sleep today or what. Amen. But I thank God that he's here. And I thank God that you're here today as well. Even those of you, listen, we got people that's in the overflow room today. Clap your hands for them. Amen. We believe the same spirit that's here in the sanctuary is there right where you are as well in our overflow room. We do want to pause, however, and show some hospitality this morning in the midst of our celebration. To those of you that may be sharing with us, visiting with us for the very first time, we don't want to embarrass you, but it is our aim and our objective for you to feel the love that emanates from our hearts this morning. Would you stand if this is your first time sharing with us here at Beacon Light? We would love to welcome you. Any first-time visitors, God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Bless you. Come on, clap your hands. Look at this. All of these men that's in the room. God bless you. God bless you. Thank you so much for sharing with us today. Listen, our leaders have a very special gift for you when you drink your morning coffee, even if you're not old enough to drink coffee, because I see some young folks out there, amen. When you put your chocolate milk in there, we want you to remember, amen, the Beacon Light Church, because we are the church where the Spirit of God is the motivating force, and we welcome you here to our church. Please, 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 we like to say here at our church, the first time you are a visitor, the second time you are family. Amen. And it's our prayer that you would come and share with us again. And we believe that today God has not just caused you to visit at the request of someone who gave you an invitation, but we believe God has you here on purpose. Amen. And that we are truly grateful for you coming and sharing with us as well. Listen, I got to say that this has been an amazing week as we have, as a church, corporately recounted the steps in the road to resurrection. Many of you joined us for our corporate reading and morning devotions. I thank God for you. Wasn't that a blessing? 6 a.m. every morning we gathered. Yes, we gathered in our virtual space on YouTube and Facebook, and we prayed together, and I enjoyed, and I was just so encouraged with many of you who normally meet us on Tuesday. But each and every day this week, many of you, whether you had to go to work or not, you were present this week, and we thank God for you. And on Holy Thursday, we gather here in the sanctuary. Spirit of God met us in a tremendous, tremendous way on that worship experience. Yes, hallelujah. It was a tremendous blessing. Had an opportunity to share in communion, to do as Jesus says. Jesus says, as I have washed your feet, he says, I want you to wash each other's feet. Amen. And in that act of grace and humility, we washed feet on Thursday night. Amen. And so we thank God for all of you who came out for that. And then on Friday, y'all, we left the church. Amen. And we went out in the community, and it was a tremendous blessing. Listen, you're going to have to clap a little louder when I tell you that several people got saved out on the street on this past Friday. You can do better than that. Come on, let's thank God. Heaven is rejoicing, and so are we. Hallelujah. And so I thank God for many of our ministerial alliance and our elders who went out as well into the street. And then we had a time to fellowship. Many of you came out there to the park. It was just a tremendous, tremendous blessing. We fried over 100 pounds of catfish, amen, and we fed everybody, amen. The children came out. It was just an amazing, amazing time. I think that's part of what we're supposed to do as a church, amen. Not just to hit people over the head with scriptures, but we should show love, amen, show love. I got a little too excited on Friday, amen, and I wanted to participate in the kickball game, amen, and on Saturday morning, I was paying for it. Like, Lord, what is this, amen? My mind said, we could do this. I was diving for balls. Y'all should have seen your pastor out there, amen. I was swinging for the fences, amen. And then on Saturday, God had to show me Father Time is undefeated, amen. Hallelujah. I ain't got it like that no more. I should have stayed on the spades table. Amen. But we thank and bless God for those of you that came out. It was a tremendous blessing. And then we decided to do an 8 a.m. service this morning to accommodate. I didn't know who was going to show up. When I got here at 7:30, it was nobody but the choir. Amen. But we had an amazing crowd at 8 a.m. in the morning. Come on, let's clap our hands for that. Amen. And here we are. Today. And today is not just special because we're celebrating Jesus's resurrection, but today is special because we have several candidates right after service that's going to make a public declaration that they're on the Lord's side. Would you clap your hands for our candidates? Oh, we're so excited. We're so proud of them, and I'm going to ask right after service. It's not going to take us very long. As we would exit, we're going to gather right there. We like to do it outside because we want the devil to know what we're doing. Amen. Want him to know that there are people in 2024 still making a decision for Jesus. Amen. So we're going to do that right after this service concludes, and I'm going to ask many of you to share in that time with us as well. A couple of things real quickly, and I want to get to the Word of God. First of all, many of you know each and every first Saturday is our time of corporate gathering for prayer, and we do it on Saturday mornings at 8 a.m. And I want to encourage and ask many of you, listen, to meet us here in the sanctuary at 8 o'clock Saturday morning as we start our month in prayer. Listen, whatever you do with prayer, you do with God. Whatever you do without prayer, you do without God. Amen. And so even during the midst of the pandemic, God challenged us as a church family to have, listen, frequent times of gathering, not just for preaching, not just for fellowship, but times where we gather to pray because, listen, prayer is warfare. Amen. How many of y'all know we're in the midst of a season of warfare? Amen. There's warfare going on all around you. And some of you, God is asking you to intensify your prayer life. Amen. So meet us here Saturday at 8 a.m. We'll be serving the city right afterwards as we normally do on first Saturday. Several people will be coming by to receive boxes of food. It's an awesome time. And then on next Sunday, we are starting a new opportunity for many of you to grow in our church. Every first Sunday, we're going to be doing growth groups or ministry enrichment classes. Many of you, as your pastor, I'm so proud of your growth and your maturity in God. And God has already spoken to us and said that this year is going to be a year where we grow. Somebody say, I'm growing this year. Amen. Yes, you are. And I'm so proud of many of you. I've seen how it is that you're walking. We're going to offer these growth groups or opportunities for you to even grow additionally with God. There'll be several classes on prayer, on leadership. Amen. And I want many of you who are leaders. Many years ago, I recognized that God didn't just call me to pastor people. God called me to pastor and to lead leaders. Amen. And many of you, whether you're in manifested leadership in the church or in the secular world, there's a leader on the inside of you. God wouldn't have you here at this church if he didn't have big plans for you. Amen. Tell your neighbor, God has some big plans for you. Amen. Come on, look at your neighbor and say, you don't know who you sit next to. Amen. Right now. Amen. Yes, 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 yes. There's a due season for all of us in our leadership. And for those of you that want to grow in that leadership, we have a class to teach you how to lead wherever you are. I'm not just talking about leading in the church. I'm talking about wherever God strategically places you, whether it's in ministry or the marketplace, that God wants you to lead with a servant's heart. And I believe this is going to take your life to the next level. For our new partners, we have a class for you that we're asking all of our new partners to participate in. And then we have a discipleship class as well. If you would like to be a part of those classes, they're at 9 o'clock, right before church. It's just a 50-minute class that we're going to ask you to commit to once a month. And it's going to be a track that's going to take your walk with God to another level. You can scan the QR code that's on the screen now if you want to register for the classes, or you can text BLGROW24 to 54244 and you can register, amen, for what it is that God is going to do in and through that class. I want us to be in prayer. We mentioned it on last week, but for Sister Dana McGarry, amen, and her particular family on this past week, they experienced, amen, transition of a loved one. Sister Dana's mother went home to be with the Lord. And so not only do we want you to pray, but we want many of you to come and stand with the family and let's encourage them on Saturday, April the 6th, over at First True Love World Outreach Ministries in Ponchatoula, as they are going to have the celebration of life service. Visitation is going to be at 9, and the funeral is going to start at 10. For those of you that would go, many of our leaders, we're asking you to meet us there as we would stand with this family during this time. Can the church say amen? Amen. We understand that our God is a God of all comfort. Amen. And he will comfort us in and through every situation in our life. Clap your hands. It's giving time in the house of the Lord this morning. You can do better than that. God has been a blessing to you. Amen. And I thank God that I'm connected to something that's active, something that's moving, something that's good ground to sow in. And I want to ask many of you to do just that on today. First of all, tithers are going to give their tithe today because you're in relationship with God. You've made a covenant with God to say, God, I recognize you as Jireh, the source of all of my provision. And because of that, listen, because I know who you are, God, I set aside a sacred portion of my finances and I offer it to you. I sow it back into the local church that there would be resources in the local church. And God says, this is my promise to you that I'm going to open up the windows of heaven and I'm going to keep the flow happening in your life. Amen. Somebody say, let it flow, God. Let it flow. Let it flow. Let it flow. And so those who are tithing are not just those who have been brainwashed or bamboozled. They are those who have a revelation that if it had not been for the Lord on my side, that I would not have, amen, income or have the ability to receive income and wealth. And so I'm going to encourage and challenge many of you to certainly do that this morning. Secondly, you're here this morning and you say, this is not my week to tithe. I did not receive income or increase, but I'm giving today. I'm sowing into this ministry. Because when you sow into the work of the church, you're really sowing into souls. Amen. You're sowing into transformation. There's so much that we have to do that we must do in our church. And so we're believing God for the resources for that to come into the house as well. I'm going to ask all of you, amen, to prepare now to lift up and not just give or donate, but to worship God, amen, with a tangible offering even on this morning. Would you take your phones out now, amen, with our deacons? speak and stand all over the house of the Lord. There may be some of you who are giving and you're giving via envelope. You're giving cash or a check and you need that. Would you lift your hands all over the house of the Lord today? Amen. God bless you. Amen. God bless you. I know we got more than two deacons. Amen. Because we got some hands that's lifted. Amen. And these people are loaded. I don't want them to put their hands down. Amen. God bless you. There you go. Yeah, back there. Yeah, they got a lot of money. That's the section back there. Amen. Amen. Come on, tell your neighbor, this is the section right here. This is the section. This is the section. Yes, yes. So deacons, let's canvass the whole place. Amen. So if you're giving online this morning, you're watching us, you're streaming us, the ways to give are there on the bottom of the screen. We thank and bless God for that as well. Let's take an opportunity and prepare our gifts. We're going to lift them and wave them before the Lord. Amen. In just a moment. Do that now. Hallelujah.
Amen. Can we all please stand? It's our prayer that everyone has had enough time to complete their offering envelopes or the use of their electronic device. Here at our church, Beacon Light of Hammond, we lift and wave our gifts. Come on, let's lift and wave our gifts to sanctify them before a holy and righteous God. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we love you. We thank you. We thank you for this opportunity right now, God, just to sow back into your kingdom, God. We thank you for blessing every seed today, God, that increase shall be our portion. God, we thank you, God, for, God, your abundance of blessings upon our life, God. It's in Jesus' wonderful name we pray. Amen, amen, amen. Repeat after me. I always have because I always give. My money is my ministry. Now at this time, if you have an offering envelope and you're in the sanctuary, you can come and lay it at the altar and invest and be blessed. Amen.
Of the Lord, say.
Joy of the Lord.
Come on and step into the joy of the Lord.
Come on, somebody give him glory.
Glory.
Oh, he's worthy, he's worthy, he's worthy.
He's worthy, he's worthy. Nobody like you, hallelujah. Oh, Jesus. Jesus, 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 Jesus.
Hallelujah. He's the sweetest name, it's the sweetest name. Amen. You're gonna have to excuse your neighbor, they're having a hard time, because every time they hear that name, they remember something that God has done for them. Our deacon told us this morning, he said, you don't need a new miracle, you need a new memory. Because when you think about what Jesus has done, hallelujah, come on somebody, give him glory in this place. Come on, we're here for that one name today. That's all. That one name. That one name. That one name. Hallelujah. You may have your seats in the very presence of the Lord. God bless our music ministry. I said, God bless our music ministry, encouraging our hearts. Oh, how precious. Oh, how precious. Amen. Is the name of Jesus. There is a name that I love to hear. I love to sing of its worth. It sounds like music in my ears. It's the sweetest name on earth. Oh, how I love Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, how I love Jesus. And the reason why I love him is I've come to realize that he loves me first. Amen. Clap your hands one more time if you're grateful for your relationship with God through Jesus Christ. Matthew 28, if you have your Bibles, amen. We want to share a few things with you today before we would celebrate with our candidates, amen. Matthew chapter 28, and I just need verse number 6. It was a part of our reading for this final day, and I pray that many of you would, even before you would retire tonight, take time to spend reading the Word of God. The Word of God is quick, it's powerful. The Bible says it's sharper than a two-edged sword, and it is piercing of our hearts and even our souls. Amen. Matthew 28, I'm reading from the New Century Version of the Bible. If you have a good phone, amen, you're able to find the New Century Version of the Bible. And for everybody else, we have the screens. Amen. You can look on our monitors and find the Word of God. Amen. This is what it says. It says in verse number 6, that's the only verse I'll need to lift up. It says, he is not here. He has risen from the dead, listen, as he said he would. The word of the Lord is already blessed. He has risen from the dead as he said he would. I want to talk about for a few moments today what he said. Everybody say that, what he said. Come on, I want you to say it a little louder so your circumstances can hear you. Say it, what he said.
What he said.
There you go, there you go. We've been in a series entitled, He is Him, talking about the supremacy of Jesus and how Jesus is better than any and everything that we could ever experience in life. And this week was, in fact, the week that changed the world. And today was the day that we have set aside to celebrate the greatest comeback story in all of history. It's a time, my brothers and sisters, of both celebration and education as we reflect on God's great love towards us in that while we were yet separated from God by sin, that Jesus died that whosoever would believe in him would not perish but would have everlasting life. It's the greatest comeback story of all time. Please know and understand that Jesus' resurrection was quite unique. It was unique, in fact, not because Jesus was the first to ever been raised from the dead. Because if you read your Bible, it's in there, it'll testify to several individuals who have been raised from the dead prior to Jesus. The Bible says this fellow by the name of Lazarus, you remember him. Lazarus, the Bible says, they sent Jesus a text message and said, Lazarus, your friend is dead. And Jesus, like some of y'all, just left them on read, amen, and did not respond or did not show up. And not only was Lazarus sick, Lazarus died. And they said when Jesus showed up to the house, not only was he dead, but by this time, he was stinking. Jesus says, watch this, Martha went out with her attitude, put her finger in the Lord's face and said, if you'd have been here, my brother wouldn't have died. And Jesus had to clap back at her and say, baby, you looking at the resurrection. In other words, anytime I show up, I'm on time. You ain't got to worry about that. He stepped out into that cemetery and said, Lazarus, come forth. And the Bible says the grave couldn't even hold him any longer. That he had to come forth, said he had grave clothes on. And so Jesus had to say, loose him and let him go. Y'all making me preach too early. Which means Jesus, listen, the resurrection has the power in his words to speak, and whatever's holding us gotta let us go. Lazarus was, in fact, raised from the dead. There was others in Old Testament history that was raised from the dead. What makes Jesus' resurrection, my brothers and sisters, so unique, what gives us place to pause and to boast and to have confidence in what this day means is that not only was Jesus resurrected from the dead, but Jesus was the only one to never ever die again. Lazarus was in fact resurrected, but ultimately Lazarus died. In Old Testament history, there were those who had been resurrected, but ultimately they died. Because you do understand, until Jesus, death was undefeated. That there was nobody who had escaped the clutches of death, because death, this final and eternal enemy, had gripped all of humanity. But Jesus' resurrection is a testimony to us that God has power and authority even over death. Well, that's good news for you and I today, because watch this, if you are in Christ, then watch this now, we shall never taste death, we just transition. This ain't no funeral, but this can help you, because you need to understand that what we do is we transition from this side to the other side, and we begin to spend eternity with God. Resurrection Sunday is a day that speaks to God's unusual supernatural story of recovery. And that's my word for all of you today. The word is recovery. Resurrection is a portrait of recovery. It's God's ability not just to cause us to recover, but unusual recovery. That out of the ruins and despair, God offers us through Jesus' resurrection an example of his power and his ability to bring us back from anything. I want to encourage your heart, because sometimes life can offer us some setbacks. So sometimes life, watch this, can knock us down, but this resurrection story teaches us, watch this, that we may get knocked down. Even the Bible says that a righteous man may fall 7 times. I wish I had Bible readers in here today, but he gets back up again. Even when we experience the unexpected and the inevitable and we don't think that we can go on, the crucial thing, my brothers and sisters, for us to remember is not what happened to you. is not who didn't support you, is not the mistake you made. The most useful and important thing you can ever retain is that recovery is possible. Somebody say that recovery is possible, recovery. And I'm on a specific assignment today for those who are in need of recovery. God told me you would be here. He told me you would be streaming today. He wants me to let you know this is not the end for you, that there is a recovery that's in place for you. The people that I came to preach to is the I would be further in my present if I was wiser in my past crowd. God told me to tell you recovery. I came to preach to the people who says things would be different for me if I didn't have that to happen to me in my life. God told me it don't matter what happened to you, recovery is possible. I come to preach to the people who says, if I didn't struggle with this issue or with this hang up, or if I didn't have this particular generational struggle in my life, I'll be more successful. I want you to know if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation, that old things will pass away and all things are made new. You can recover from whatever setback that life has thrown at you. I'm here to preach, and I'm trying to target you right now for those who say these were just the cards that I was dealt in life, and I'm just going to accept what life has thrown at me. No, baby, resurrection teaches us that all things are possible to them that believe. Can y'all help me with that one word? Can you just say it? Recovery, recovery, because somebody need recovery in their finances. Somebody need recovery in their relationships. Somebody need a recovery in their health, and God told me to tell you that resurrection teaches us that God is a God of recovery. Hallelujah. Touch your neighbor and say, you ain't gonna stay where you are. You ain't gonna stay where you are because God has brighter days for you. Recovery is possible. Recovery is possible. And you have something on the inside of you, in case you don't know it, called, if Christ lives in you, called the Divine Buoyancy Project. And with divine buoyancy, it means that there's something on the inside of you that no matter how low you go or how deep you fall or how more life press you down, sooner or later, you're going to have to rise back to the top. I got about 50 of y'all that can agree with me in here this morning that you've been knocked down before and you say, Lord, I don't know how I'm going to get back on my feet. I don't know how I'm going to walk through this by myself. And God had to show you, baby, when buoyancy is with you, you like cream. You always rise back to the top because recovery is possible for you. Oh, you ain't said nothing yet, but somebody that went through a divorce and they said you'll never love again, recovery is available for you. Somebody that done been in jail before and you trying to get your record expunged so people won't know about it. God says, I know about it and you still gonna bounce back. I'm talking to somebody that had a real public situation, but God said they talked about you in public and they gonna have to see you come back in public because resurrection is what God does for us. Shout it out, recovery, 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 recovery. And I want to submit to your for observation this morning this story of recovery that we celebrate today. I want to submit this for your observation because when we peer into the Word of God, you have to understand that the story of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the story of resurrection, is the greatest recovery story in all of human history. And it involves you and it involves me. In fact, I want to share with you this morning that the Bible is a story of, is a book of recovery. That from Genesis to Revelation, the whole book talks about bouncing back. The whole book talks about recovery. The whole book, if you read it with the right lens, you can begin to see that the whole book is designed to teach you that it ain't over till God says it's over. I know your neighbor don't need this right now. Everything is going right with them. But can you put this in the back of your mind to know that God is saying out of any situation, I'll bring you back from it. And from Genesis to Revelation, the Bible is teaching us that recovery is possible. Recovery is possible. Oh, I feel something in the room right now. Recovery is possible. that there's somebody right now, you've been doing a good job zipping it up. Don't nobody know what you've been struggling with, what you've been fighting in your own private time. Oh, but I come as God's man this morning to let you know that the enemy that you see today, you shall not see them again, because God says when I recover you, when I resurrect you, you're going to be so resurrected that it shall not appear what you used to go through, because God's going to make everything brand new. This story is a story about not just how God created, but how God put contingencies in place. Contingencies. He didn't just create. He had a contingency. God, if we had to give him a social profile, God is a type A personality. Do I have any type A personality folks in here today? Yeah, I know some of you. You're sitting in here today. In case you don't know, you've never taken the test. These are the people who got to have everything planned out. These are the people, you don't want to go to the concert with them. You don't want to go on vacation with them because they got to have an agenda. Mm-hmm. They not like you and me, because see, when I go on vacation, I don't need no agenda. I'm going to wake up when I get through sleeping. Amen. That's what I'm going to do. Well, I'm going to eat what I feel like eating that day. I don't need no agenda. Don't be telling me we going here at 10 o'clock. I might not get them put clothes on till 11:15. Amen. But when you got type A, let me tell you how you can deal with them, because everything in their life got to be scheduled. And they get unnerved, they get disturbed when things don't go according to their schedule. Where my type A people in here today? I want to let you know, you ain't get that from your mama neil. You got that from God, because God is type A personality, which means he saw the end from the beginning. That God had everything scheduled out. In fact, he said the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. I already planned out what it is that your life was going to go through. Watch this. And I made contingencies. Because sometimes in life, things don't go according to plan. Sometimes things don't keep up with your schedule, so you got to have a contingency plan. Y'all know what a contingency plan is, right? Is if this don't happen, then we're going to do that. And if that happens, then we're going to do this. And if this don't happen, then we're going to have this built in. And if this don't come out, then we're going to have that. God had that. He had a plan. Because the Bible says that before the foundation of the world was laid, the Lamb was slain. He's saying, I don't want man to sin, but just in case man sins, I already got a clean up for their mess up even before they messed up. I want to let you know, watch this now, it did not catch God by surprise when you did what you did, or said what you did, said, or smoked what you smoked, or got entangled with what you got entangled with, because God is a master strategist, that God is a planner, that God say, I saw it and I had a plan in place to get you back when you drifted off. Or you ought to clap your hands right there, because if God was like some of us, he would have kicked you to the curb the first time you messed up. But God says, nope, my grace and my mercy is so deep and so sufficient that every time you messed up, I gave you another chance, and I had another path, and I had another option to bring you back. Somebody ought to give God praise, because he knows my future from my birth. Oh, you know you wouldn't be here today because you so smart, but the Bible says, lean not to your own understanding, but all your ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. Hallelujah. Oh, and why you all nervous and can't sleep and you all messed up because your plan ain't working out for your 2024, I come to let you know you are right where God wants you to be. Because God says, ain't no panic in heaven. Ain't no panic going on in the throne room. He already has a plan for you. Because there is no panic in heaven. There's just plan. God says, watch this, when sin separated us, when God, because he's so holy and so righteous, when sin had caused humanity to be thrown away, he says, I had a plan. He says, I had a plan in Genesis. When Adam sinned, I had a plan, and the plan was named Jesus. Oh, you didn't think we was going to come in here this morning and not talk about Jesus, right? On this day right here. Yeah. The plan from the beginning. Wasn't no other plan. It wasn't Muhammad. It wasn't Buddha. It wasn't Confucius. It wasn't Osiris. The plan was Jesus. That at the name of Jesus, every knee is going to bow and every tongue is going to confess that he is Lord. Somebody say that name, Jesus. That was the plan from the beginning. That in the beginning, the Lamb was slain. And so when we read the Bible, we're reading a plan unfolding. We're reading now stages and phases of God's strategy. I'm helping you out right now. That wherever you are in your life, you don't need to get discouraged. You don't need to get so overwhelmed. But you got to know if you are His. You got to know that if you have His seal on your heart, that you got to know that God has a plan for you. I don't care how much you messed up. I don't care how much you have went astray. God has a recovery plan for your life. And God says, watch this, my plan all along was Jesus. But I want to cause you to peer into this story because as of Friday, the plan looked a little suspect. As a Friday, the plan looks a little shaky, God. Because the plan, by close of business, Jesus had died on Friday. Your plan. This divine plan of recovery and redemption, he's dead. And things happen so fast. That Jesus, y'all remember I shared this with you on Holy Thursday, that on Thursday, he just had dinner with his disciples. You remember the story? They were in the upper room. Yes, the 12 of them were sitting around the table and Judas was with them. I ain't got time to teach on Judas, but everybody needs to know, no matter how small or how tight your circle is, everybody got somebody in the circle that will sail you down the river if they just get a platform, if they can just get, watch this, a little bit more upliftment in their life, they will sail you down the river. But my assignment ain't about Judas, but my assignment is to tell you that Judas was in the room. And the Bible says they was having Passover meal. You got to read your Bible, church. And when they was having the Passover meal, Jesus made things real awkward and real weird in the room because Jesus looked around the table and he says, one of you are going to betray me before this night is over. Can you imagine sitting at that table like, oh God, who is he talking about? Who is he talking about? And one by one, they used to say, Lord, is it I? Lord, I ain't gonna ever do it. And Peter said, ain't me. I'm gonna be with you. They come get you, Jesus. they gonna come. I'm down like 50 grand. They gonna be with me. And they begin to go around the table until it happened to be Judas. And then Jesus pushed back from the table. The Bible says he stood up and he girded himself. Oh God, I'm getting excited all over again. And he did something he had never did before. Jesus making it awkward. Jesus started washing their feet. Because he says, I didn't come here just to do the clean work. I came here to do the dirty work. That anybody who would ever have dirt in their life, he says, I want to come and I want to clean you up so you can sit at the table of God. I wish I had somebody in here right now that you say, I got some dirty feet. I got some stuff that I need Jesus to wash out of my life. And that was on Thursday. And the Bible says they got up from the table. They sung a hymn and they marched out and went to the Mount of Olives to pray. Things happen so fast. You know what that lets me know? That lets me know you better live. Because life will come at you so fast that it'll have your head swimming. I don't know who I'm talking to here this morning. Things happen too fast and too short for you to be wasting time in life, for you to be holding petty grudges, for you to be dealing with petty things, for you to be wasting your time, you to be depressed and you to be overwhelmed. You better live right now. Stop talking about when you retire. Baby, you better say, look, I'm going to take my PTO, prepare the others, because I will not be here. I'm going to go and I'm going to live because I don't know if I'm going to make it till a retirement. I'm going to live right now. Can I give you a liberty in this house right now? You have the authority right now to live your life. Oh, slap your neighbor and say, because you don't know how much time you got left. You talking about retirement and you might not even make it there. But what I do have is today. Hallelujah. Look at somebody say, do it right now. Do it right now. Do it right now. Oh, I'm going to go on vacation when I get my money right. No, my money right now. I'm going to gas this hoopty up. I'm going to drive and I'm going to park somewhere. And I'm going to say, God, I thank you for letting me live. Touch somebody right now and say, it's our season to live. It's our season to see the world because things happen too fast. Oh, I'm coming after every one of y'all that's wasting time on social media all day, soaking up all of the hours of your day, the creativity of your mind, worrying about if did it. You better do it. You better go out and do life like God wants you to do it. Things happen too fast. They happen too fast. Look at somebody say, they happen too fast. That's why I told God, God, I ain't gonna wait till next Sunday to praise you. Cause things happen too fast. I'ma praise you while I have a chance. Next Sunday, I might be here looking at the roof of the church. So I'ma bless you while I have a chance. I'ma give you glory while there's blood running warm in my body. Slap your neighbor and say, you better do it right now. You better, I know you're trying to look cute. I know you got your Easter hair on, but you better push that to the side and say, I will bless the Lord at all times and his praises. Things happen so fast. They happen so fast. Settle on your saddle. They happen so fast. They happen so fast. I don't know who I'm talking to, but I'm preaching to somebody right now. You've been sitting there waiting, and you've been sitting there waiting for the right time. You like we used to be when we were playing double dutch, that you don't even understand. You sitting there like this the whole time and don't even know sooner or later, baby, you got to jump in that thing. Sooner or later, you got to get in life, and you got to say, hey, I'm in this thing. I'm ready to do it because I don't know how much time I got left. Slap somebody high five and say, live, live, live. I know that happened to you. I know they walked away from you. I know you don't have the support, but live like God said you could live. It happened so fast. It was just having a meal on Sunday, on Thursday, and here it is Friday. They done arrested him. On Friday, they done marched him from courthouse to courthouse. On Friday, all in a matter of a couple of hours, they convicted him. On Friday, everybody done came out in the street and they marching Jesus up Calvary's Hill. Things happen so fast, y'all. I can't get that out of my spirit right now. That is the issue I have. The Bible says, watch this, not only were they crucifying him, but they was trying to embarrass him. It wasn't just about killing him. Killing him wasn't enough. They wanted to destroy his influence over anybody who would ever say he was the king of the Jews. And I didn't have a problem with the Pharisees and what they said. I didn't have a problem with them spitting on him. I expected them to go that low. That's who they are. I didn't have a problem with the people who was making memes about him and TikTok videos about him. I didn't have a problem with the folks that was doing all of that about it. I didn't have a problem that people that was sharing the picture when he was carrying that cross and kept falling down. I didn't have a problem with them because they are the people I expected to do that. The people I have a problem with in this text, Lord, just me, is the people that were silent. That's the people, because the Bible says that everywhere Jesus went, there was a crowd that went with him. And when he performed miracles, there was a crowd that received of his miracles. I want to know where them Negroes was. I want to know where was the people that he healed? Where was the people that he restored? Where was the people that he did all of these things for? Because you're going to know who's who when things get tight in your life. Where they was? Where they was? Come on, ask your name, where they was? Where they was? Where they was? Come on, where they were? Where they were? Where Peter? Where Peter and his mother-in-law? Y'all remember he healed his mother? Where was Lazarus? Lazarus, where you at? Isn't it funny that some people who you walk through life with certain things, issues in their life, now when it's your turn to be dealing with your issues, they do a Houdini on you. You can't find them. Where were they? It was Dr. King who said, and I quote, that history will have to record that the greatest tragedy of the civil rights movement was not the strident clamor of bad people. But the greatest tragedy of the moment was the applauding silence of good people. That the only reason that evil can keep going forth is because some good people won't open up their mouths. I wish I had a witness in here today, and some of y'all sitting up in here on Easter Sunday just like the silent crowd, because God has done so much for you, but you on Instagram talking about you flexing. You on Instagram talking about you a boss lady or a bad boy. No, if it had not been for the Lord that was on your side, you better give God his glory. You better let the world know, if God hadn't opened the door, if God hadn't kept me, if God didn't cause me to recover. So they got him up on the cross. I'm trying to make my way to verse 26. They got him up on the cross, y'all. And crucifixion was a slow process. It wasn't meant to kill the criminal instantaneously. And it's three of them that they're doing today. They're doing it wholesale. Three. Gotta go. Three of them are there on the cross. And one of the soldiers says, listen, because it's Passover that's coming on Saturday, we got to be finished with our work by the time the sun goes down. Because when the sun goes down, nobody else can do their work. I give that to you one more time. You were still rejoicing over the last point. They said they got to hurry up and do what they had to do, because when the sun goes down, nobody is able to work. I'm going to tell you one more time for the people in the overflow, that you got to do what God had called you to do, because when the sun goes down, nobody is going to be able to work. You got to do what God has called you to do in this lifetime, because when the sun goes down, nobody is able to work. And they said, we got to speed this process up. It's taking too long. And one of them got the bright idea. They said, what we're going to do is we're going to break their legs. Because crucifixion wasn't about the nails. You don't die from the nails in the hand or the nails in the feet. You really suffocate because you can't breathe. And so they said, if we break their legs, they won't be able to push themselves up and take a breath. And so they went to the first criminal and they broke his legs. And he died within a matter of minutes. They went to the second criminal and they broke his legs and he died within a matter of minutes. And then they went to Jesus and they had the bright idea. They said, we ain't gonna break his legs. We're gonna spear him in his side. And when they speared him, I love your word, God, in his side, the Bible says, out came flowing both blood and water. You got to know that blood was for the redemption of your sin, and water was the baptism into your new life. That you got to tell that devil every time he want to bring up your sin, that the blood. Don't y'all do this to me. The blood has washed away all of my sins. And not only did the blood wash away all of my sin, but the water that came gave me a new lease on life, that I don't have to be the person I used to be, but I can change my life because I got new life in Jesus. Mm-hmm. They didn't break his legs. They pierced him in the side. And what they didn't understand is that wasn't just a witty idea, but the word of God says that when you sacrifice on behalf of sin, you got to bring a perfect lamb. That the lamb can't be broken. The lamb can't be spotted. The lamb can't be deformed. The lamb cannot have a blemish. And so the word says that not a bone is going to be broken in his body. So the enemy thought that he was getting at Jesus by sticking him in his side, but he didn't understand there was a word over Jesus' life. And because there was a word, you couldn't break the bones. Can I tell you something? There's a word over your life. And everything the enemy wanted to do to you, he can't do to you, because there's a word over your life. I wish I had a witness in here right now. Slap your neighbor, say, there's a word over my life. There's a word over my life, because I should have been dead. I should have lost it all. I should have had it all messed up, but there's a word over my life. Slap your neighbor, say, thank God for the word. Thank God, thank God. Thank God for the word. Thank God for the word. Because they couldn't break you because there's a word over your life. They couldn't totally destroy you because you don't own me. God owns me. There's a word over your life. The reason I can get up from whatever knocked me down is there's a word over my life. I'm talking to somebody right now. God says there's a word over your life. Oh, you might as well give him praise. You know there's a word over your life. You know you ain't that lucky. You know you ain't that slick. You know you ain't that good. There's a word, there's a word, there's a word over your life. Yeah. And if I was at my daddy's church, I'd close like this. I'd close and say, they hung him high. And they stretched him wide. He hung his head in the locks of his shoulders. And then he died, y'all. I said he died, yes. He died until the earth shook like a drunken man. He died until time stood still. He died until one of the soldiers said, surely this was the Son of God. He died. Watch this, watch this. He died. And when he died, the story wasn't over. But the Bible says that Joseph came. Joseph was the secret disciple, who was also a Pharisee. Touch your neighbor and say, he is preaching up in here this morning. Yeah, I'm gonna give it all to you today. I'm gonna give it all to you today. I'm gonna give it all to you. It was his secret disciple, which to tell you that anytime you're in any situation, watch this, God has somebody there looking out for you. I wish I had a witness there. I know you think you all by yourself, but nope, God got somebody that's on your side, but they ain't said they on your side yet. The Bible says when Jesus died, he had Joseph on the council. And Joseph went to Pilate and say, can I get his body? He's been good to me. Let me take his body. And I know we gotta hurry because when sun go down, can't nobody work. And so very quickly they wrapped his body in linen. Watch this. They put God's recovery plan in a tomb. Read your Bible. The Bible says, watch this, we ain't gonna just put him in the tomb because we know his followers are so adamant that he gonna get up. And so we don't want them to come and steal the body and fake a story that he got up. Mm-hmm. Because if they do that, then everybody's gonna believe that he was who he said he was. I enjoy teaching your word. So they took a stone and they put a huge stone in front of the tomb. And they said that might not be enough. It's a lot of them. And so they sealed the stone. Mm-hmm. With a seal of Rome, which says anybody that touches this stone is touching Rome's property. Not only did they put a stone there and put a seal there, but the Bible says they put a soldier on guard. And the soldier had to sit there, and he could do to whoever came to try and move the stone whatever he wanted, because they said, we're not going to let them fake a miracle. I come to let somebody know in this next season of your life that you ain't going to have to fake a miracle. You ain't going to have to take fake pictures on Instagram. You ain't going to have to get the right angle. No, God says, when I get through with you, you're going to have something that's authentic. You're going to have something that's going to let you sleep at night. You're going to have something that's going to give you joy. Slap your hands right now, hands with somebody. Tell them God's going to give you the real thing, baby. God's going to give you, watch this, houses and land. He's going to give you peace and joy. He's going to give you contentment and hope. He's going to give you the right stuff. And they said, we got it covered. We got it covered. They know they can't do it now because we got the stone. I'm done. We got the seal. And we have the soldier. Oh, Lord, help me. But the Bible says, early on Sunday morning. See, that's my Baptist folks. That's my Baptist folks right there. That's right. Let me say it one more time. The Bible says, early Sunday morning. That's why it says, there was an earthquake that hit the land. And the Bible says, watch this. There was an angel that came down. See, when you thought the stone meant you wasn't gonna recover, and the seal meant you wasn't gonna recover, and the soldier meant you wasn't gonna recover, I want to let you know God got an angel that's watching over your life, that God got something that's stronger than you, that's more powerful than you, that can handle whatever you can't handle. I need you to shake your neighbor's hand, tell him we got angels, baby. We got angels, and the angel came and moved the stone and broke the seal and slayed the soldier, and Jesus came out of that tomb. I wish I had a witness today. He rose on the third day, and he says, all power is in my hand. Good evening, church. May the Lord bless you real, real good. But I stopped by to tell somebody, you can recover from whatever it is that's holding you back. Shake your neighbor's hand and say, neighbor, if the stone can't stop you, if the seal can't stop them, if the soldier couldn't stop them, who shall stop the love of God from flowing into our life? Say yes. I feel somebody that got a leap in their spirit. I need you to start leaping, because I shall recover everything the enemy took from me. Say yes. 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 Ain't he all right? Ain't he all right? Yes! He got up from that grave and he had all power. Listen, listen, this is what they said. They said, y'all came to see Jesus. He's not here. He has risen. Listen, just like he said he would. Touch your neighbor and say, it's going to happen just like God says. It's going to happen just like God says. It's going to happen just like God says. It's going to happen. Come on, if somebody else tell them, then you need to encourage them. Tell them, you got a word over your life and it's going to happen. Just like God said. Bishop, how can you preach with such conviction? With such passion? How do you know God's going to come through? Because I seen him do it. I seen him move stones. Come on, I seen when governments are against you, I've seen him break the seal. Come on, when men would stay there to try to guard what God has for you, I've seen God move enemies out of the way. It's going to happen just like he said he would. Because we have a God that causes us to recover. My time is up. I'm sorry for keeping you so long. Would you stand all over the building today? God wanted me to tell you this remarkable story this morning of recovery. Ooh, God, I feel the presence of God in here. Yes, so no matter what situation you're in, how much despair is at your front door, you can hold your head high and say, God, if you did it for Jesus and I am in Christ, then that same triumphant spirit that was on Christ is on my life as well. Touch your neighbor, say, it's on me, it's on me, it's on me. Is on me. Come on, touch them right now. But I want you to prophesy to them. Tell them everything is about to live again. Everything is about to live again. Come on, those things you walked away from, those things you gave up on, those things you say, God, it is what it is. God says, I'm about to put life on it. You can't sit in that addiction. God says, you're going to recover. I know you got fired. You got laid off. Them people came, got their stuff. You had a rough moment, a rough season of your life. You lost people that was close to you. God says, I know. But you're going to keep going. He says, your head is going to be lifted up above your enemies. God says he's going to remove shame from you. Because some of you trying to save face so you won't get embarrassed. That's all right. Jesus got embarrassed, but God got the last laugh. I want to let you know, listen, you don't have to keep hiding in the darkness because you made a mistake or because something happened in your life. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be ye lifted up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory will come in. Recover. 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 A righteous man falling 7 times, but he recovers. He gets back up again. When I was playing football, we used to do this drill. I'm about to pray. We used to do this drill called up-downs. 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 We had to sit there, and we had to chatter, and then coach would blow the whistle, and we had to fall down on the ground and then pop back up. I never could understand why we had to do up-downs. If you was late for practice, 300 yards of up-downs. Every 5 yards, you had to hit it and get back up, hit it and get back up, hit it and get back up. And the whole goal of the drill was this, that it's impossible to play the game of football and not get knocked down. It's impossible. I don't care who you are. You can even be the kicker. It's impossible to play the game and not get knocked down sometimes. Oh, God. And can I tell you something? The more important your position was, the more you got knocked down. I wish I had a witness here today. And some of you are wondering, God, why am I going through this? Why I keep getting knocked down? It's because the most important positions are the ones that get knocked down the most. But God says, watch this. I got to train you in the game of football that when you get knocked down, you're not knocked out. That you got to learn how to get back on your feet. You got to learn that, no, I'm going to hit the ground and I'm going to bounce back up. I want to speak this over somebody's life. God is showing you how to bounce back. You went through it. You got knocked down, but it ain't over for you. You're going to live again. You're going to live again. And let me tell you what I know about God. God never ends on a down note. He always ends in better. I don't know who I'm preaching to right now, but some of you right now, you're in a crucifixion situation, and God says, he told me to tell you Sunday morning is coming. Resurrection is coming. You're going to get back up again, and you're going to live. I want to pray now. I want to pray. Join hands with that warrior next to you. I'm over time. If I had time, I'll let them tell you how many times in life they've been knocked down. How many times in life they've been heartbroken. How many times in life that life knocked the wind out of them. But they had to learn how to trust in God. They had to learn how to take him at his word. They had to learn that many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers us out of them all. They could tell you how many times they had to battle sickness. One of our members who stay in Texas, she texted me the other day. She says, Bishop, I'm back in the hospital still dealing with this pneumonia. She's probably watching right now. And I text her back again. I say, and the word is still, you're going to recover. The word is still, he's going to heal your body. Some of you don't know that you've been knocked down several times, but the word is you're going to get back up again. Come on, squeeze that hand right now. They're dealing with something that has knocked them down, but God says, nope, you're my child. You're my child. You got buoyancy. 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 You've been out of work for a while. You got buoyancy. You got buoyancy. He's still been providing for you because you got buoyancy. You got buoyancy. You got buoyancy. Hallelujah. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for this word today that encourages us, Lord, that if we are in you, the power is not in us, but the power is in you. That even if we get knocked down, we can't stay down because there's a resurrecting spirit in us that causes us to get back up on our feet. I speak this prophetically now over every person under the sound of my voice, God, that they're going to get back on their feet. Every person that they got a doctor's report, they got a verdict against them. I pray today that they receive this prophetic word as they would leave here on Resurrection Sunday. You're going to get back on your feet again. Every person who had their heart broken and now they're saying, I can't do this again. God says, you're going to get back on your feet. Weeping may endure for a night. But joy is going to come in the morning. So somebody that lost somebody that was so close to them and they're like, I don't know how I can go on today. I speak full recovery for you, that God is going to heal you. And he says, I'm never going to leave you. I'm going to be right there with you the whole time. Because he's a God that never leaves. 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 I'm trying to end this. He's a God that never leaves us. So Father, we thank you and we bless you today. That as we celebrate, we can get empowered, that the resurrecting power of Jesus accompanies us into every dark valley we must face and every shadow we must walk through. And I thank you that today we get the boldness now to say, yay, like David, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You have anointed my head with oil. Yes, there's oil on your head. Yes, you've anointed my head with oil. And thank you, Lord, I was empty when I came in, but my cup runneth over. Oh, God, surely good and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord. Your presence shall be with me forever and ever. In Jesus' name, amen. Drop those hands. Come on, clap for your neighbor's recovery. Come on, clap for their recovery. Clap for their recovery. Hallelujah. Clap for their recovery. Listen, we're about to go outside and celebrate with our candidates in just a moment, but I don't want to end this service without giving you some of you an opportunity to come to Jesus. You've been wrestling with some stuff, man. You've been trying to hold some things together, zip it up so you can be strong for people that's dependent on you. But God says, listen, if I'm not in your life, you're fighting a losing battle. You've been trying to hold it together, and you've been trying to say, God, I can do it. Nope, nope, nope. God says, I've already did it. Why are you trying to do it? I finished the work on Calvary's cross. And now all you need to do by faith is accept my son. And when you accept my son, I'm gonna say that you are righteous. And now you receive all of the promises, the protections, and the provision that righteousness affords you. If you're here today and you've never accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, it's just the fact of the matter that I believe he got up from the grave. I believe that he finished the work on Calvary's cross. If that's you today, sir, if that's you today, man, whether you're in the live service or you're in the overflow, one of our leaders will lead you here to this altar. I got to have a word of prayer with you before I dismiss this crowd. Tell your neighbor, excuse me, I want you to get to this altar. Come on, if you got to walk with somebody because they don't want to walk in front of this crowd, come on, I want you to say, come on, I'll walk with you up there. I'm your real friend. I ain't like Judas. I ain't gonna sell you out. I ain't gonna leave you. I'll walk with you to the front because I want to see your life transformed. If that's you all over the house of the Lord, I see you. Come on, clap your hands. They're coming. They're coming. Come on, clap your hands. Come on, clap your hands. Somebody in overflow, the Spirit of the Lord is talking to you right now. He's saying you don't have to stay where you are. All things are possible to them that believe. If that's you, I want you to come all over the house. Secondly, you're here today and you've already accepted Jesus, but you strayed away. You're not growing. You're not maturing. You're not developing and cultivating like God wants you to. And you're here. You're in this sanctuary today. You're in the overflow. And you say, I'm coming back to God. I strayed away. I thought God was mad at me. But listen, no, God ain't mad at you. God says, I've been waiting on you to realize that I was the best thing that could have ever happened to you. And it's been me the whole time that kept my grace upon your life. If you strayed away for any reason, today I want you to put all of those excuses down, and I want you to come stand at this altar with these who are here. I'm gonna have a word of prayer with you. You know what the Bible says? God's gonna receive you back. He's gonna put his ring back upon your finger and the robe back upon your back. And you're gonna have a joy like you've never ever known before. If there's anybody that says, you know what, I strayed away, but I ain't leaving here the same way I came. I'm coming back and I'm getting in relationship with God. There's about 7 or 8 of you that need to walk right now and come and stand at this altar. I'm not gonna put the mic in your hand. I'm not gonna say anything to you, but I'm going to have a word of prayer with you. Would you come even at this time? Tell your neighbor, excuse me, get to the nearest aisle, stand here at this altar. I'm gonna have a word of prayer with you. While they're coming, thirdly, there's some of you that's supposed to be a part of this ministry. This is your blessed place. This is a place where God is going to speak to you. He's going to empower you. He's going to develop you as a disciple. And I want you to come today because God is saying today you're coming back home. Today you're going to connect with your brothers and your sisters who is your spiritual family. Would you come today and would you stand here at this altar? When I pray for these who have walked out, I want to pray for you as well. Whether you're in overflow or you're here in the sanctuary, would you come very quickly, very quickly? Would you come? There's several of you who are here. The Spirit of the Lord says now he's tapping at the door of your heart. He can't force you to do it, but he can give you an opportunity to let you know recovery is possible. Mm-hmm. And if you're here today and you say, I'm tired of being in what I am in, I'm ready to recover. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on to Jesus. He's waiting for you, amen, with open arms. Is there somebody here today that need to give God a yes, that need to give God a yes? I want you to come and I want you to stand with these. And when you stand with these, watch this, watch what God does in your life, amen. Glory to God, hallelujah. Ask your neighbor, if you need to walk, I'll walk with you, amen. Come on, see, you said around known person, he ain't say nothing to you, amen. Tell him, if you need to walk, I'll walk with you, amen. Tell him, I don't even know you, but I know your life will be better if you give your life to Jesus, amen. Come on, that's it. You can come all over the house of God this morning, amen. Very well, I'm about to pray, I'm about to pray, I'm about to pray. I'm waiting on you, sir. That's it, come on. Come on. Come on, clap your hands. I got some haters in the room. If you're not a hater, I want you to celebrate what God is doing. Hallelujah. I'm about to pray. I'm about to pray. There's 3 men right now. There's 3 men in the house of the Lord. And I realize as men, we're trying to process everything. We're trying to reconcile everything in our mind. But the Bible says, the day you hear my voice, harden not your heart. Amen. And I believe that the voice of the Lord is talking. There's 3 men that's in this room right now. When I was talking about recovery, you was like, man, that's what I need. I need a recovery. I need a recovery. Come on, sir. I see you. God held the whole service up for you. God held the whole service up for you. Where those other 2 men? I'm behind time. I know. I'm sorry. God held the service up for you. Where are those other two men? There's other two men. You say, man, I've blown it. I'm just going to stay where I am and do what I do and get it how I live. No, God says he has a recovery for you. He has a recovery for you. Amen. And Bishop, when you pray for that man, I want you to pray for me as well because I'm in that number. Amen. Where are you? Where are you? Where are you? I want you to come. I want you to stand. And I'm going to have a word of prayer. Yeah, there he is. Come on, clap your hands. There he is. There he is. You shall recover. You shall recover. Is there somebody else? The Lord is talking to you. The Lord said three men. There was three men that were supposed to give God a yes today. Where are you, sir? God says, I'm waiting for your yes. There he is. Come on, clap your hands all over the building. Come on, can you clap and celebrate like that's your nephew? Come on, clap like that's your godson, like that's your baby you've been praying for. You shall recover. Stretch your hands here towards the altar. Father, I thank you now for everyone that has come. Some of them are standing for one thing and others are standing for something else. But I thank you that you're going to meet them right where they are. That every need, Lord God, you're going to care for. I thank you right now for the sinner that's coming to you for the very first time saying, God, I'm messed up, but I need you to help my life recover. I thank you today, Lord God. They're going to meet a Savior like they've never, ever met before. I thank you for their future because you have a bright future in you. To the one that strayed away, Lord, they've been wrestling and battling with condemnation and conviction and all of this kind of stuff, shame. I thank you that you're taking that away. And now that they're going to receive the righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ. I thank you that they're going to have a testimony that you can fall down, but God will let you get back up again. He'll cause your life to make a U-turn and come back and get what you missed before in the last season. I thank you for those that's going to become a part of our church family, Lord God. We're rejoicing today because we have a new brother, a new sister in Christ. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen, amen, and praise God. Would you clap your hands all over the building today for these who made a decision? Listen, I thank God for your bravery. For your honesty, for your transparency, coming and saying, God, I'll be vulnerable before you today. If one more act of obedience, would you turn to my right, your left, follow Elder Mitchell. She's going to lead you into the back. Just going to give you some quick information, and then we're going to allow you to be released. Come on, clap your hands for them. Hallelujah. Glory to God. We're about to share with our candidates. Clap your hands for Minister Glennon says he will come and give us our benediction. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Amen. So listen, before we leave out on today, can we get a round of applause for all of our baptism candidates who are going public on today? So at this time, I'm going to ask our baptism candidates to leave out on my left, your right. You may go ahead and head out towards the pool at this time. Let's celebrate them again as they leave. Yes. All of our candidates, we have them all ages. Amen, amen. Yeah, come on, yeah, celebrate them. We have 12 candidates today. And listen, I'm gonna ask that the immediate family members of these candidates, they may exit at this time as well. I do have one ask of order. One ask of order. As we watch the baptism, I'm asking that no one waits on the stairs. Everyone, please go all the way down for safety. Everybody say safety. We ask that you gather around the pool in a semicircle. I have deacons outside who will guide you. Let me give you your benediction. Father God, how we love you on today. We thank you for that one word of recovery, Father God. Now, Father God, as we leave from this place, but never from your presence, keep a hedge of protection all around us. It is your Son, Jesus' name. We believe this and everything in it is so. Amen.